Oh, right. You had mentioned that when you were here one afternoon, the first afternoon you were here to at Earth Day headquarters unpacking the stuff, that you could begin to see where Joris was kind of going with this huge 20,000 square foot barn.
Yes.
So can you tell me about that, like what you began to see emerging?
Yes. Yeah, first of all, that was at the end of the Earth Day where everybody else in the park had gone home.
Yeah.
And then Joris had all this stuff that naturally he didn't want to throw away because it was useless. As Suzie was talking about the early Earth Days that just each year.
Yeah.
So in any case, going in the barn, and I think there were several different trucks, just volunteers, people came by with the stuff, and Joris was directing where I should go. And what really stood out in my mind was that he kept talking about the five-bay barn. The lower level, having grown up on a farm, the lower level was obviously the cattle and animal area.
Yeah.
But the open barn was built with timber frame and a perfect example of other barns in the valley. And given that each was a bay, it was almost like that's what I was seeing from Joris, that we can use this for this, we can use this for this, we can use this for this. This could be an area that we work on woodworking and other things in any kind of weather. And this bay over here can be the residence and was beginning to be the residence.
Yeah.
So going in, and I think right from that time, I think the bathroom on the lower level was already done with the hand-laid stone and the really unique structure there. And then the kitchen area, the living area was starting to be there. And much later, I think the addition at the top, which we see now, was done.
Yeah.
And I'd probably get back to that. But Joris's next idea, which I think came a little bit later, was to expand so that we could actually have learning events and common gatherings and things like that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So that very quickly led into Morningstar, the idea of Morningstar,
mm-hmm.
which came together as everybody's idea, everybody who was involved at that point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a little brochure, as most nonprofits have with that, and I think this is another thing that Joris probably did. Yes, yeah. You can see again, it's not just humans, it's nature and, you know, all the other pieces of it.
Uh-huh.
There's always a mission. I don't know if the mission is...
Just saw your name, Richard Lane.
Yeah.
As one of the board members.
Yeah. So in any case, we got together in the general mission. What does it say? It's a center for... Morningstar is an open community, learning, teaching center, and spiritual oasis. Okay, which is very broad.
Thank you.
Yes. So that came together just by discussing how can we make this a nonprofit, and with a little bit of experience with that, with a couple of people I had, including myself, we got the materials together, the formal material, and sent them off. And I noticed going back through the materials that the IRS officially responded September 26, 1995, saying, based on the information you supplied, you're a 501c3 nonprofit. So anything that we did, raising funds or holding events or whatever, we could refer back to that nonprofit.
Yeah.
And I think the original board had... Some of the people, and I wish they were around here, but they aren't at this point.
But you are.
Yeah. Lynn Lehman, with her Native American background, Lakota, as it's written here, she had traveled extensively throughout the world, and I think continued to travel, and embraced the beauty and essence of the world religions and aboriginal cultures, but that was a more common term at that time, instead of indigenous. She teaches meditation, facilitates trance dancing, drum circles, and is a certified hypnotherapist. She also did sweat lodges mm-hmm. here.
Right in the back, in
yes.
that corner.
Yeah,
yeah,
I think so, yes. And Joris and Joanne Jones, I won't go into a lot of detail, Larry Lefebvre, who was a student and involved here pretty much in holistic science, scientists and activities, Jeff Vitelli too. I don't know if you know Jeff Vitelli.
No.
So he was on the board. And additional board members, Diane Buskirk, Laurie Martin, Davina Short, Thomas Wolfe. I think Thomas might still be around. Thomas is an artist.
He's
and
in Arizona, I think.
Is he?
Or,
okay.
Or New Mexico, somewhere.
Yes.
So these people are around, but they're
different
out
places.
They're around.
Jeff Vitelli's still in town.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. What is Jeff Vitelli? What does he do?
Well, he's I know he has been a therapist.
Okay.
I think there were several musicians. I'm not a musician. I wouldn't say that. I'm a lover of music. Yes. Jeff, in addition to being a musician, writer, community activist, peacemaker, Jeff is a nationally certified counselor with a master's from Lehigh in counseling.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what made it up. And then Joanne did a lot of the scheduling for
okay.
things that were going on. But I noticed there were events going on all the time. So this is just one calendar. Each month
wow.
had a pretty full calendar.
Wow.
Joanne was doing yoga. There was Tai Chi here. In this month of January 97, the reason I had this is because I was doing a workshop called Dancing on the Rim, which I didn't have to do anything with because it was all about local holistic practitioners. In each one of the weeks that people met, there was a different holistic practitioner coming
wow.
in just to share their craft. A lot of this was in the evening. It raised some money for Morningstar. Yeah, you can have that. You can have this too, of course.
Tai Chi, yoga,
yeah.
esoteric healing, and Reiki energy.
Yes. Yeah.
Dancing on the Rim, the Way of the Healer. Did
yes.
you attend that?
That was my idea. Of
oh, that was
dancing
your
idea. On the Rim. Yes.
Oh, yeah. I see what
so,
you're saying.
But
okay.
then people joined in to say, I could do this. I could.
Yeah. What is that concept, Dancing on the Rim?
Well, for me, my concept is that we're on this big round ball, which we call Earth, and above us is a very thin layer of atmosphere
mm-hmm.
where everything we know happens from there to here in a few inches, sometimes a few feet of the ground. But the rim is what nourishes everything that goes on.
Mm.
And when people talk about capitalism or talk about, well, we have to build this or we have to grow or whatever, that's what they're doing, is they're using all of this
mm-hmm.
because without this, we wouldn't be able to breathe.
Right.
We wouldn't have water to drink, which
yeah.
our bodies are mostly water, and nothing would happen.
Yeah.
So that's the dancing on the rim, is we need to dance with this. We need to understand what it is, and there are
nice.
Various ways
yes.
of realizing that,
yeah.
each in our own way,
yeah.
and where we come in and find our interests and contribute our own beings
right.
to it as an ongoing thing,
yeah.
generation after generation.
Yeah.
So
that's beautiful.
So that's, in a nutshell, that's...
And so these are the types of... This is what you saw happen, is those bays
yes.
now became a place for workshops like this to happen.
Yes.
Learning, connection. I mean, it's so much more than learning. It's really, I mean,
immersion.
Say it again.
Yeah. Immersion. Immersing
immersion.
Ourselves.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Immersion. Community immersion.
Yes.
Yeah.
Food. Food. Dance. Drumming.
Yes.
Sweat lodges.
Right.
Yurts. Anything.
Yeah.
Building. Yeah.
Right.
Tools. All those things.
Yeah.
According to what you're drawn to.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
what you can share.
According to what you're drawn to and what you can share, there is space for that here.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
There is space to dance in whatever creative dance you have to offer to the rim. And do you have any memories, recollections, stories passed on about some poignant workshops or immersions that were happening here that maybe you feel connected to or that you really like to remember?
What I have in relation to Morningstar during that period, the earlier, for me, earlier means sort of later, 2003, 2004.
Yeah.
I remember coming to an open house. I think it was the first time I came here. And it was so new to me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was old. I remember dreaming about such things when I was a young teenager.
Okay.
But I had given up on those dreams.
Yeah.
I thought that all of that was, no one else seemed to understand or believe in such things, so I guess I'd better put it aside and get to real living.
Yeah.
And so I did for many decades. But then I came here, and this person was up on the stage in the barn. First of all, when you went into the barn, they had this smoke, and they were doing something with it, and it was a little ceremony, and I remembered how ceremonies seemed so important to me when I was little, and then they were doing a ceremony, and I walk through, and then I sit in a chair, and there is Joris, after a bit of time, on the stage of the barn, telling a story about how when a bird banged against the window of one of the windows of the barn, his house, you know, the house part of the barn, and I don't know exactly where it was, but he could look through the window and see the bird, and he just picked up his hand and he sent the energy to the bird, and he was telling the story. Me, I had just come in, smoke, a person who looked like, I don't know, everyone's respecting this person, and he's telling this story about sending energy from his hand to a bird.
And he's on a stage.
Yes, he's on a stage, and then the bird, like, wakes up, shakes himself off, and looks straight at Joris through the window, looks at him, and then Joris said that he felt something right here from that bird, and they understood each other. And then the bird just got up and flew away. And I had read about people talking that way, but I had never heard an actual person in front of me telling a story like that, much less someone who people are sitting and looking to. Someone who just seems so connected and so intelligent and so admired saying that this.
Mm-hmm.
And it was mind-blowing to me to start to remember things from when I was younger.
Yes.
And start to feel like maybe I can start to wake some of these things back up again.
Yeah.
And that's the way it's been for me ever since.
Yeah.
And I think that's true for many, many, many of us.
Yes.
To have feelings about what's true when we're young,
mm-hmm.
be discounted. And so we just have to adapt, we have to conform to what we think reality is.
Mm-hmm.
And we do, and we forget. But now we can remember, because there's
a place like
there's
this.
There's a place like this, where other people who remember those things and start to bring them into the present again.
Yes.
And they can learn from each other and start to support each other to bring those memories back into the present. And that's the way it feels to me.
Yeah.
And that's sort of the way it feels to me on a wider scale. But this is a nexus of that.
Yeah. A nexus for remembering, playing, immersion.
So many things playing against each other to make things come up.
Yes.
And you brought up so clearly the story, the oral tradition, the storytelling aspect of it.
Yes.
Which is the way we actually learn is through the stories, our own stories, our own shared stories.
Yes.
And they're as informal and deep as that that you described. And the need for a talking, that's something in Morningstar we really do, is a talking stick.
Yes.
So everyone would pass the talking stick around so everyone could share, because otherwise you would only get a piece of what the gathering was, the community was.
Yes.
So that was one of the essential principles. And the workshops were all like that, maybe with a key person, but everyone was part of that. We were not an audience, we were a gathering. Yes. For everything, including council.
Right.
Council of all beings is a perfect example of that.
So there was a stage, but the stage was not for preaching. The stage was for oration, for storytelling, for
highlighting. So you could hear and listen and respond.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
And there were also community dialogues here. They may have been sponsored by the Alliance. They were here. I don't know whether they were. I don't know those details. I was just taking part. But that affected me deeply too, the whole thing of sitting at a table with a few other people with the talking stick, because I'm a person who has been in the habit for so long in just holding back and staying on the edge, but then all of a sudden I'm given the stick, and then not only do I have permission, but I have a little bit of a responsibility to make my contribution. And that was very powerful for me.
And not thinking of a particular script. This is this is not let's see, let's go to the notes next comes this. So
So they weren't business meetings. They weren't like agenda. It was literally just what are we all thinking and feeling
about? The agenda flowed out of it. What are we talking about today?
And then maybe from that activity would be born. Or an event might be inspired.
Yes. Yes.
Or a movement.
Yes.
Or a let's go do that. Or.
And I think I mentioned Shakti Gwain, who came here.
No, same work.
Well, you know, well, and I was saying to Suzie, creative visualization is what she shared. And so there was a bigger event over at Cedar Crest that was a lecture.
Okay.
But she was over here in a group. We were all eating various foods that had been prepared, and we were all talking about what is creative visualization. And we think this is what we do here all the time, is creatively visualize what comes next. So in the stream of things, not to have a beginning and an end, but so. Yes.
I would love to do something like that right now.
Yeah.
Thank you. Maybe pause?